How are you doing? I had my little set list, which I spent all of 2 minutes writing down. So I can either... It's your choice, really. I can either go through the songs that I've got here, or we could do a question and answer thing and see where it goes. Well, maybe we'll do a hybrid. If I run out of songs, I'll answer a question.
Dear God, is there somebody out there? Is there someone to hear my prayer? I'm a simple man with simple words to say. Is there some point in asking for more? Only God is where we are today. We're lost and alone and afraid. Who gave me love for the lonely? In a restless world, so give me hope for the children. Give me one worldwide religion. Give me some peace in a restless world. So dear God, can you hear me crying? A whole world crying, looking for something to say. We had it all and we threw it all away. Is there somebody watching? Somebody watching over the mess that we made? We're lost and alone and afraid. This world, oh, give me hope for the children. Give me just one worldwide religion. Give me some peace in a restless world. And we need to know there's something good. All ideas of such will go on.
Did he drag his sorry ass up here? No, he didn't.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. He's lovely.
So I've left them all down there somewhere, crossing the weird side of the border. When I lived here for a year, and my kids were talking to someone saying, "It's we love it here. It's like, it, you know, it's like kind of like America." And the guy said, "The big difference is we only shoot things with four legs here." Enough of that. With every waking breath I breathe, I see what life has dealt to me. With every sadness I deny, I feel a chance inside me die. Give me a taste of something new, to touch, to hold, to pull me through. Send me a guiding light that shines across this darkened life of mine. Breathe some soul in me. Breathe your gift of love to me. Breathe your word and set me free. To see, to make me breathe. Breathe some honesty. Breathe your innocence to me. Breathe your life to live for me. Breathe to make me breathe. For every man who built a home, a paper promise for his own, he fights against an open flow of lies and failures we all know. To those who have and who have not, how can you live with what you've got? Give me a touch for something sure, I could be happier more. Please, I'm soul in me. Breathe your gift of love to me. Breathe your word and set me free. To see, to make me breathe. Breathe your honesty. Breathe your innocence to me. Breathe your life to live for me. Breathe to make me breathe. This life prepares the strangest things, the dreams we dream of, what life brings. The highest highs can turn around, and sow love seeds on stony ground. Breathe some soul in me. Gift of love to me. Breathe your life to live for me. To see, to make me breathe. Breathe your
set me free. Breathe to make me breathe.
Thank you. Thank you very much. There's one universal thing that happens in this bizarre industry of mine, and that is that every artist you can think of only became an artist because he loved someone else's work. And that, I'm glad to say, is still the case. And I still hark back to, you know, my days in Glasgow, wandering around the streets looking in guitar shop windows, licking the window, hoping to have a guitar one day. And music's a wonderful thing, isn't it? It's you hear something on the radio, or, you know, a doorway or whatever, and you haven't heard it for ages, and it instantly takes you back to who you were hanging out with, and who you fancied, who didn't fancy you, and the clothes you were wearing, and all that stuff. So I want to play something right now which still resonates with me today. And this is from, I suppose, everyone's got a Desert Island album. And this would be my Desert Island album, so I'll try and do it justice. Christmas, David Bowie. And we all owe a nod of respect to the man because he changed the face of music forever, and we all benefited from it. Isn't it great to see this stuff happening with Kate Bush?
Yeah.
Where have all those people been for 40 years?
Not alive!
Well, they've got a wealth of material to catch up on, you know. Wonderful stuff. I'd do my duet with her, but she's not here. I did do a duet with her. I'm laying my claim to fame on doing a duet with Kate Bush. I bet she never mentions it to her fans. So this is, as I said before, I'm from the streets of Glasgow in Scotland, and this song was written about there. But it's kind of universal. I think kids in general, irrespective of whether it's kids today or kids back then, always get a rough deal. You know, there's nowhere to go and there's nothing to do and you get no money and, you know, all of that stuff. And this kind of came about because of those early days. And a few Scots amongst you will probably recognise some of the reference points. Is listening to those records from the past. He wants to make them last, for they make him feel alive. They are the voices of the faces on the wall. He listens to them all, hangs on every little tale we tell. Knows them all and their life stories, shares their pain and shares their glories. One day he even got their names upon his skin. They mean that much to him. Well, then he'd take the test. His bedroom windows opens to the evening air. The foxes in his lair. The volume of his system is full on. And the neighbors moan and the parents call. This angry noise is the music of the wastelands. In the fashion of the day, the kids all dress that way. You can tell them anywhere. The boy looks out and sees his friends awaiting there. In the cold electric glare of those lamps that make you think that night is day. Drag their lusts into your sight. With shouts and screams, they meet the night. They block your way in twos and fours, in uniforms from city stores. They're closing in, who knows the score? It won't be long before a martyr's blood is nourishing the wastelands. Listening to those records from the past.
He wants to make them laugh before they make him feel alive. They are the voices of the faces on the wall. He listens to them all and hangs on every little tale they tell. Knows them all, and their life stories, shares a pain and shares their glories. They'll knock their way in twos and fours, in uniforms from city stores. They're closing in, who knows the score? It won't be long before a martyr's blood is nourishing the wasteland.
A gazillion years ago, and I never sang it. So I'm going to do my little acoustic interpretation of this now kind of quasi classic electronic dance hit.
Oh, how's he going to do that? Who knows?
Maybe 10 years ago, when the mighty Ultravox got back together again for one last rodeo roundup. And we actually did two tours. I mean, it's so sad. I mean, musicians are pretty pathetic people. You give us something we enjoy and we want more and more and more.
And we got together to play the old songs one more time, with no other intention than just doing that. Because once we had done it, we wanted to do it again.
Yeah.
But we had to make an album to go out and do it again. So we made an album that I was very proud of.
Very good.
And we kind of discovered this song again. I keep finding things that I've done in the past that have gone off. I've got loads of songs that I don't like that I've written. And then I don't listen to them. You walk away from them and then you pick it up again and you play it. And all of a sudden it's got a new life. So this is a classic example of that. But it's weird to do it on an acoustic guitar, like most of these things are. So next time round, I'll have to drag a few musicians with me and make a racket rather than... second to tune. Everything's better if it's in tune. Or probably not with this song. Song that will remain nameless by a band that will remain nameless. And while I was on there with this song, which had nothing to do with it, other than the fact that I sang it, the reality is that we turned up from Glasgow to London with a great big truck full of equipment to make our first record. And as we walked in, we could hear the record playing in the background. It was written and produced and played by the same people who did all the Bay City Rollers tunes. And this thing got to number one in the UK. And when I got the phone call to tell me it was number one, I felt nothing. It was just the most bizarre thing ever. The number one in the charts, and it had nothing to do with me at all. And so I'm on Top of the Pops, and I hear this song in the charts. And I vow that one day when I grow up, I'll do a cover of this. I'll make music that I want to make, not what other people want me to make. So at one point, I did a cover of this.
Thank you.
Sorry, this is a rental guitar. My guitars, of course, never go out of tune. I want to get this one in tune because I like this one. More top one here, please, not on the guitar. Thank you.
Thank you.
fool. A voice reaching out of a piercing cry, it stays with you until
touches to Fade to Grey, and I got a phone call saying Philip Lynott's going to call you in a minute, and I knew Philip, we were friends, and he did. He said, I'm in Arkansas and we're special guests for Journey. We're playing Megadomes and Gary Moore is out the band. Can you come out tomorrow and finish the tour? And I went, yeah. Whether I was good enough or not didn't really matter. I mean, I'd never been to America before. So I got home that night, and on my doorstep was a box of cassettes and a set list. and an envelope with a plane ticket in it, and an itinerary saying cars coming to pick you up in about 3 hours' time, because it was really late. So I packed my bag, got my big ghetto blaster, 1979, that's what I remember. And my headphones, and I thought, I'll learn the songs on the way out. Because they flew me out in Concord. So I was halfway through the second song and we landed in New York. And I got a connecting flight down to New Orleans. I'd seen America. I'd seen Starsky and Hutch and stuff like that.
That is American.
New Orleans was nothing like that. I was in Nice, or you know, south of France or something. So yeah, that was it. But I'm not going to play a Thin Lizzy song. Let me do a song, hold on. A song I wrote about Philip. He was a lovely friend, but you couldn't really trust him with your girlfriend or your wife. I can say that, you can't hear me. I wrote this when he died. Because it was one of those things that he got so close so many times, and when I was told, because we were the same management company eventually, and when I was told he was really bad, I kind of did what everyone did and went, oh yeah, really? Yeah, okay. That'll sell a few tickets for the next tour, won't it? And it was. It was bad. So I wrote this for him.
Too easy.
your questions while I'm on a roll.
See,
you're all at it now. Okay.
How crazy was Band-Aid?
How crazy was it? It wasn't that bad, actually. The whole thing about leaving egos at the door of the studio, it's exactly that. Nobody acted up. I think some of them did, but that was acting up with each other rather than acting up as in, hey, I'm a rock star, I need special treatment. There was none of that at all. I think Duran and Status Quo got up to some naughty stuff in the toilets. But other than that, there was no food, no drinks, there was nothing laid on, no record company people, there was nobody hanging about, no servants, nobody could snap your fingers and they'd go and get your drink. Boy George turned up late, and he said, oh, I've got a bit of a throat, I need some brandy. And I had to press the button on the mixing desk and say, well, the Indian shop's round the corner, it's still open, you can go and get one. There was no one to do that stuff. It was really low key. In fact, the best bit, the most rock and roll bit of the day was Geldof was walking round the studio when I'm at the desk. I never left that desk 24 hours. And he's walking round and he bumped into John Moss from Culture Club. And he said, where's George? John said, I think he's in New York. He said, where? He's supposed to be here. He said, well, he's in some hotel somewhere. He said, get me the hotel number. So he called up and woke up George in the middle of the night or whatever it was there. And he said, what are you doing? He said, I was sleeping. He said, you're meant to be here. He said, is it today? I mean, bear in mind, we hadn't spoken to any adults about which day it was or which studio it was or written an address down or anything. We just trusted these people to get there. And he said, well, I can't really make it now. And Geldof said, you have to. He said, well, who else is there? He said, every fucker be you. He said, there's a Concorde leaving in a couple of hours. Get on it. So George went out and bought a ticket on Concorde. And turned up at 8 o'clock that night, only to find out he had to go and buy his own brandy. It was very low key, it was very unlike, we are the wind. Where there were carved fish spouting caviar or something, I don't know, it was very odd. Anything else?
Aye, White China.
No.
No. Okay. Whose idea was it to do the comic relief in Love's Great Adventure video?
Oh, the stop?
Yeah.
Right, Love's Great Adventure, the video where we went to Kenya and acted out our Harrison Fordisms. It was mine. I guess we were directing the video, and I happened to have a little recording Walkman, and I just thought it would be really funny hacking your way through the desert and running out of puff, and stopping and going, hold on, and then start the thing again. The great thing was, Top of the Pop showed that video, because someone had dropped out. Lucky for us. And they showed the video, but they hadn't run the video. They'd seen the beginning. I thought, yeah, it's fine. And it went out live that night, and it stopped in the middle. And you could just see all these suits running around, pulling their hair out, thinking the whole thing had broken. While I'd puffed and panted, and then got on with the rest of the song. Love's Great Event. Can I do that? No, I'm not sure I can. I can, hold on. Standing on my own, it didn't mean that much to me. I thought I had it all. I didn't see the mystery. I stood the test of time and took the steps to find love's great adventure. To me, they rang around my head with empty, tuneless harmonies. The great adventure, oh,
by side. It didn't mean that much to me, but starting to enjoy the poetry and symphonies, I took it in my stride. I hailed the day I tried the great adventure. A fool who couldn't see, it didn't mean that much to me. I couldn't understand that how the game was meant to be. The great adventure. It didn't mean that much to me. I thought I had it all. I didn't see the mystery. I stood the test of time and took the steps to find the great adventure.
Trying to get off, I'm looking at the watch so that I don't overrun over Martin's set upstairs. We're old friends, and I don't want to hit these very, very tall. Ah, sure, we'll load it in.
If I was a
Influenced me. I think, like all of us, we go through musical tastes, you know, not just as a musician, but as a listener, a consumer. And what you like when you're 12, you don't like when you're 15. But it stays with you. So all those influences I've had from listening to the radio, you know, Small Faces, the Beatles, all of that stuff, Boy, Roxy, Kraftwerk, Le Dusseldorf, all of that. It's all in there somewhere. It's all kind of what makes you up as an individual. So it's not just music. I mean, we're all like that. We're all individuals because we've got different books that we've read, or different things that influenced us, or different movies that we loved, or a great school teacher you remember or taught you something. And that's what makes us the individuals we become. So all of those things are still in there. And I wouldn't dismiss any of them. I did a covers album quite a while ago, weirdly in Montreal, and I just chose all the songs that I seem to remember from the radio, and they were all really melodic, beautiful songs. Now, whether it was whether it was Alfie or you know, a Queen song, it didn't really matter. I wasn't trying to be cool. I was just saying, here's where I got my sense of melody. That and traditional Scottish songs. Because in our school you weren't allowed to sing pop songs. You got your step, Wiggly Young Wiggly. That was it.
Do it.
See, he knows it.
Do it.
He was taught as well. Oh, no. Please. Did you know, Andy Stewart ever sing one of my songs? I don't think he did. So, any other questions?
Live
Aid. Strange, Visage, Rusty Egan,
how did Steve Strange, Rusty Egan, and Visage come about?
Yeah.
I bought a synthesizer in 1978, and I introduced it to the band I was in at the time, the Rich Kids, and half the band hated it, so it instantly split the band up. The half the band who loved it was Rusty Egan, the drummer, and myself. And Rusty was doing some DJing in a little club in London called Billy's. And on a Thursday or a Tuesday, I think it was a Thursday, he used to take this club over and call it the Bowie Night. You know, club for heroes. And right in the middle of the second generation of punk bands that were going on, who weren't very good, the original punk bands were great, The people who started the whole punk movement, the kind of Bromley contingent they were called, they got bored with it and wanted to listen to what they used to listen to, T-Rex, Roxy Music, and David Bowie. And he mixed all that with electronic music he was hearing coming out of Europe. And that was the birth of the Blitz, the whole Blitz Club. And we were on pennies per week with the Rich Kids. And Rusty made money by DJing, and he used to take me out and feed me. Sad but true. Cost a pound to buy a meal, and he would treat me now and again. And Rusty talks a lot, and I mean a lot. And one of the times he was talking, we were walking down the road, blah, 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 a million miles an hour. He said, wouldn't it be great having a band with all the favourite musicians in it? You know, the guys from Magazine, the guys from Ultravox, and the guys. And I went, whoa, stop. What a great idea. Let's do this. So that was it. We got all our favourite musicians together to make music, to play in that little club, or eventually the Blitz. Nobody expected Fade to Grey to do what it did, but thank God it did, otherwise I'd be dead.
Thank you.
Sorry, thank you. Well, thank you for still living. Thank you.
Is Roland UK still pissed at Warren Cann for reprogramming all the drum machines?
A technical question. Roland UK, Roland manufacture synthesizers, for anyone who doesn't know, and that's millions of people. No, I think they probably quite enjoy the fact that we made one of the biggest songs on the planet using one of their drum machines, and I think they probably quite like the idea of that. I think they're forgiven for reprogramming anything because of that. So if it wasn't for that and all the others, I'm just about to blame myself for all the dance shit that's been on for 20 years, and I'm not taking that. Not that for me. I am not responsible for all that square box. Well, four on the floor and no melody. Thank you.
In Live Aid, do you are you there?
Yeah, I'm back.
Yeah. In Live Aid, do you still have the great guitar? And did you meet Freddie Mercury?
Yes, I do still have the great guitar. It was one of my. Well, it wasn't a folly, it was a bit of a bizarre idea. I went to see a play in London, and the entire stage set was grey. I loved it. I thought it was fantastic. So I insisted that Ultravox have an entire grey stage set, including painting all the instruments. The drums were grey, the guitars were grey, the violin was grey, the keyboards were grey, and the band was grey. And it was fabulous. It was a great thing to do. So the guitar that I used at Live Aid, the grey guitar, it's now in an exhibition in the British Music Institute in Liverpool. So you can see the Live Aid coat and my Burberry raincoat from... Yeah, my raincoat's more famous than I am. People recognise it, but they walk past me in the street. So yeah, it's still got that. What was the other part of the question?
Did you meet Freddie Mercury?
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
Yes, just the ones. I'd met all the rest of Queen because they used to hang out. They used to do television shows together and whatever. And Freddie always kept himself completely separate from everyone. I don't think it was aloofness. I think he just had his own little circle. And we just finished the British part, the UK side of Live Aid, and the backstage area wasn't actually backstage. They had porta cabins backstage for the artists about to go on stage, and then when you came off you got changed and you got kicked out your porta cabin for someone else to come in. It's the way it works at festivals, because there were so many artists on. And the actual backstage area at Wembley Stadium was Wembley Arena, which was only half a mile down the road. So couple of weird things happen. When you step off stage after singing, Did You Know It's Christmas, and a great big security guy scoops up an armful of pop stars and pushes you into a little, little van thing. And then you're in this van going from backstage at the stadium to backstage at the arena. Of course, the first thing you do when you're in a situation like that is you look around you to see who else is in the van with you, in case they're more famous than you are and you crash and they get the headline. So I looked around and there's the two guys from Status Quo who were just the funniest people. So it was all getting really quiet and all puffed out and elated and excited, and it was just a magical moment. And it all went very quiet as we caught our breath. And one of the guys from Status Quo said to the other one, "I don't get it." And he said, "What don't you get?" He said, "Why are we singing Feed the Welsh?" So we get to the backstage area. And I'm walking down the corridor. And without a word of a lie, there's Freddie Mercury sitting on the edge of a pink fountain. And I don't know where the pink fountain came from, but it was very apt. And he spies me coming down the corridor and he goes, "Darling, darling, come on, darling, come on." So I think, "It's Freddie Mercury, I've got to go and say hello." So I say hello and shake hands. And he said, "Wasn't that wonderful?" I said, "Yeah, it was great, it was fabulous." And we're chatting away, and about 5 minutes into the conversation, he still got my hand. And I glinted his eye. Mercury was rising, I think. And he said, "You're that lovely boy from the Boomtown Rats, aren't you?" That was my one time that I met him. Amazing character. Amazing. He stole that day. It was just magnificent, the whole thing. Between him and Bonham, it was brilliant.
Great day.
I had to play something because he didn't pay to hear me talk.
What other question will you?
Oh, no, just put my ear back in. One last question. Go.
Will you come back to Toronto again next year?
Will I?
Yes.
If you ask me. Yeah! The problem is, I'm listening to the radio on these, so I don't know what you're saying. Yeah.
Right, okay. So we've got...
Once before, slip
washing over me. Voice. They try the shape and the power of the voice. It's the wrong tones. Oh, the shape and the power of the voice.
I hope that's not all you've done. You can't let the legend walk on stage. If you enjoyed that.